إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار All praises due to Allah, we praise Him. We ask Allah's assistance and we seek Allah's forgiveness. And we seek refuge with Allah from our evil souls and our bad deeds. Verily, whomever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. And whomever Allah allows to go astray because they do not want any guidance, then no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy of our worship except Allah alone with no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and His messenger. May Allah exalt His mention, grant Him peace, His companions and all those who follow them on their righteous path until the Day of Judgment. O you who believe, have taqwa of Allah by doing what He commanded and staying away from what He prohibited, the way Allah deserves it, and do not die except in the state of submission. As to what follows, verily the most truthful speech is the book of Allah, the Qur'an. And the best way of life and guidance and example to be followed is that of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of affairs are the ones that we introduce into this deen of ours. Because every newly introduced matter is an innovation, and every innovation will lead astray, and whatever is astray, it'll be going to the hellfire. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the topic of tonight is one that is hardly ever discussed. It is something that is usually set aside as if is it some trivial issue. Whereas, it is really more important than most other subjects that we hear during these lectures, or Friday sermons, or the general reminders, or otherwise. It is of fundamental importance to our lives. And to prove my point, all one has to do is look at the condition of the Muslims today. Actually, me and you will do a self-evaluation. How often have you been to a lecture? And how often have you attended a Jumu'ah? And how often have you read a book? And how often have you come across reminders? Yet, where are we? Huh? What have we done? How many of these reminders or evidences that we came across did we actually put into practice? Have our lives improved? Have we become better? Or are we the same? It is a disaster of devastating magnitude. It's beyond comprehension how one can ignore the fact that throughout these years, he does not move or she does not move. It's like a CD player. You know the ones, the CD player that comes with a tape player and a radio, right? It looks nice, call it boombox, I don't know what they call it nowadays. It looks nice and fancy, nice buttons, everything, you know, digital and everything. But it has some rusty, expired batteries. And so, if you press play, after you pop in the CD, it will not play. You change the radio frequency, and it's not going to make any sound. You press rewind to rewind the tape, it will not rewind. Because the batteries are bad. They're old, they're expired, they're rotten. And this symbolizes our hearts. We may look alright on the outside. Rather, we spend a lot of time trying to fix that. But unfortunately, we sometimes fail to notice the internal, which is the heart. But if one was to read the Quran, if you ever read the Quran in a language which you understand, of course, many of us will pick up the Quran in Ramadan and say, I did one khatim, brother, two khatim, three khatim, mashallah, tabarakallah. Tell you, brother, what were you reading? What did Allah tell you in the Quran? Oh, I don't know. What does this ayah mean? Oh, I don't know. Did you try to learn Arabic? Not really. I need to learn French because my job requires of me to learn French. They told me if I learn French, they will increase my salary. But then if Allah had made it possible for you to learn Arabic so you could increase your salary in the hereafter, not for me. But fine, the Arabic is beyond you. I know sometimes there are no centers for you to even learn. You want to learn Arabic and it's not being provided. Malish. Did we read it in a language which we understand? In case you have, then when you read the verses where Allah deals with those people whose hearts have become corrupted, then the least that should happen to you is that you should become terrified, as if you have watched a horror movie. Terrified. The consequences of a hard heart. And this is where melting the iron hearts come from. This is where the title comes from. Allah says in the Quran, سأصرف عن آياتي الذين يتكبرون في الأرض بغير الحق وإن يروا كل آية لا يؤمنوا بها وإن يروا سبيل الرشد لا يتخذوه سبيلا وإن يروا سبيل الغي يتخذوه سبيلا ذلك بأنهم كذبوا بآياتنا وكانوا عنها غافلين. Allah says in the Quran, I shall turn away, I shall divert away from my signs, from my proofs, from my evidences, from my reminders. Those who act arrogantly upon the earth with no right. And whenever they see a sign, an ayah from Allah, they don't believe in it. And if they see the path of consciousness and guidance, they don't take it as a path. But when they see the path of destruction and deviance, then they take it as a path. This is because they have denied our signs and they used to be heedless concerning them. وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا وَنَسِيَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ يَدَاهُ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَنْ يَفْقَهُوهُ وَفِي آذَانِهِمْ وَقَرًا وَإِنْ تَدْعُهُمْ إِلَى الْهُدَىٰ فَلَنْ يَهْتَدُوا إِذًا أَبَدًا. Who is more unjust than he who is reminded of the signs and his verses of his Lord, but then he turns away from them and he does not see what his hands have put forth. Those, Allah says, we have placed coverings over their hearts, lest they understand the reminder. And in their ears, there's deafness. Deaf, he doesn't hear. And even if you were to call them to guidance, they shall never be guided. You speak, you remind, the khatib gets on the minbar, he loses his voice. Nothing changes. The lecturer sometimes tries to be soft, sometimes tries to be rough, sometimes tries to bring it in targheeb, trying to encourage and incite, sometimes tarheeb, threatening, frightening. And sometimes nothing changes. And there's nothing more, nothing makes a da'iyah, any one of you who is involved in da'wah, nothing makes you happier than when people respond. You see? Hoping that Allah will accept the deed. And nothing makes you sadder than people turning away. The Prophet ﷺ, Allah told him, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِن لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. Perhaps you will kill yourself over them. If they don't believe, if they don't follow the trace of guidance, out of regret and grief, Prophet ﷺ, he would become sad when the people turned away. He would warn, and people are heedless. And anyone involved in da'wah feels the same way. It is not about, mashallah, tabarakallah, brother, praising the brother afterwards. Very good lecture. I like blah, blah, blah. Tayyib, jazakallahu khairan. But That's not what the lecture is for. That's not what these gatherings are for. This is not a social club. We love to see each other because we are one brotherhood. But in order to help one another, as Allah described us in Surah Al-Asr, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Nothing more than that, brothers and sisters in Islam. So I'm saying this because those involved in da'wah, they observe the brothers and the sisters around them. And they see whether there are changes happening or not. Whenever a change takes place, all praise is due to Allah. But whenever it doesn't, then it must be addressed. And this particular lecture is dedicated to address this problem. Why do we not change? Why do we not improve? It's because of our hearts. فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. So when they deviated, Allah caused their hearts to deviate. So the affair is serious. Because if your heart is not sound, if the reminders don't benefit you, if you hear the statement of Allah and His Messenger, and you don't take heed and put it into practice, meaning there is a disease and illness. And unfortunately, when it comes to physical illnesses, we will go to the doctor immediately. No delay. No delay. If you felt your heart, you know, beat, it wasn't consistent, or some pain in the left arm, you know, heart attack, or what precedes a heart attack, a person will not wait. Unless he cannot afford it. They will be ala tool in the hospital. Say, doctor, check me, man, something's wrong, I may die. My family, my wife, my children. What am I going to do? I'm still young. طيب يا أخي, your heart may be dead. It may be much worse. Because that kind of death involves the hereafter. Involves destruction and humiliation and disgrace in the hereafter. And that cannot be rectified. You may die today and go to Jannah. But if you die with your heart dead, then Jannah is far away from these individuals. And if you have any other objective besides Jannah, then we need to reconsider what we're doing in Islam. I mean, why are you a Muslim? What was the ultimate goal of the Rusul and Al-Anbiya? To enter Jannah. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, the biggest muwahid during his time. Then the Prophet is the biggest muwahid afterwards. He used to say, وَجَعَلْنِي مِنْ وَرَثَةِ جَنَّةِ النَّعِيمِ. He begged Allah, begged him to make him among the inhabitants, the inheritors of the Garden of Delight. And that's what it is, brothers. And you cannot go there. I and you cannot go there with a busted heart. You cannot go there with batteries that are rotten, old and expired. The machine will not work. And so we will try to address this issue in such a way where brothers and sisters will wake up from this deep sleep that we have been suffering from. Perhaps Allah will put some blessings and some success in these reminders. So in case one of us is suffering from a dead heart, this will be the last night. And inshallah, beginning tonight, not tomorrow, we will repent to Allah and work on fixing our hearts up. Actually, most of the things that I'll be quoting to you are from Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, rahmatullahi alayh, the second Shaykh al-Islam after his Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And Ibn al-Qayyim, he used to be called Tabib al-Qulub, the doctor of the hearts. Allah gave him some amazing knowledge when it came to the intricate aspects of one's heart and how it is guided or it is misguided based on the evidences. And so when I try to, I have the book in Arabic, that is, the book is called Al-Fawaid. And when I try to translate that to English, alhamdulillah, there's on the internet something that is much better. So basically, I could not afford to ruin the excellent translation by a brother, I don't remember his name, with mine, which will pretty much murder the translation. Because of that, I will prefer to be quoting verbatim, word per word, to some extent, with some addition and deletion, what the translator translated from the statements of Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. So bear with me, because I will be using the note cards predominantly. because I really don't want to get too involved in this. I want the message to be delivered as it was given by the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. Because this was his field, it is not necessarily my field. So hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, you will find in it the beneficial reminder. First and foremost, let us deal with some of the verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encouraged us to acquire a soft heart. Rather, Allah reprimanded the believers in the ayah, Surah Al-Hadid, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ وَلَا يَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدُ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Allah says in the Quran, interpretation of the meaning in English, has not the time come for the hearts of the believers to turn with humbleness and submissiveness to the reminder of Allah? Isn't it time that your heart humbles with submissiveness to the reminder of Allah and that which was sent down from the truth? And that we do not become like those who were given the scriptures before us, the Jews and the Christians. Allah says, فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدُ. So the term was prolonged for them. The time passed while they were heedless. فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. So their hearts became hardened. وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. And most of them were evildoers, corrupt and disobedient to the command of Allah. Allah says, isn't it time that our hearts soften to the reminder? So we will not become like the people of the book. They became, their hearts became so hard that when the message came from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they rejected it. Although they knew, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. They know him as they know their children. But when the heart is hard, you go crazy. In common day, you know, language, you become nuts. How could you reject the Messenger of Allah whilst knowing that by rejecting him you are guaranteeing eternal punishment in the hellfire? But Allah says, إنها لا تعمى الأبصار ولكن تعمى القلوب التي في الصدور. It is not the sight that goes blind. Rather, it is the hearts and the chests. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ. And whoever Allah does not provide any light for guidance, he shall have no light. So this is a reprimand from Allah that we shall not be like those people. And it is time that our hearts soften to the reminders from Allah. And Ramadan is around the corner. An opportunity to return. An opportunity to return. But we don't wait till Ramadan because no one guarantees that he will live till Ramadan. So don't let the shaitan fool you. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Zumar, to support the previous ayah, أَفَمَنْ شَرَحَ اللَّهُ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ فَهُوَ عَلَى نُورٌ مِّنْ رَبِّهِ فَوَيْلٌ لِلْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ مِّنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُّبِينٍ. So is the one whom Allah has expanded his breast to embrace Islam, to accept Islam, as a non-Muslim to enter into Islam, and as a Muslim to accept the teachings of Islam, like he who rejected, like he whose heart rejected. Then Allah says, so woe to those whose hearts are hardened against the remembrance of Allah. Those are in manifest error. You stand in the salah, and it is a yawning session. How many times one can yawn? How many times one can explore the surroundings, wondering who went by and who stood next to him and what is engraved on the walls of the masajid and who made the carpet? You know what I'm saying. Mind is gone, heedless, absent-minded. We're not really, and the brother is reciting the Quran. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا mutasaddi'an min khashyatillah. La ilaha illallah. If the Quran was sent out upon a mountain, ya shabab, if all of us came to push a mountain, the mountain will not move. We can't do nothing. But if the Quran was sent down on a mountain, it will crush from the fear of Allah. And we are flesh. The strongest thing you have is a bone, which if you fell on your arm, you may break. Let alone rocks and mountains. Still, in the salah, the opportunity to wake up. If in the salah we're not doing it, then don't ask about what happens outside. You see, why? Because we don't know what is being said. This is an indirect encouragement for everyone here to learn the deen of Allah in the language of revelation. You say there are no places. وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. If you have taqwa of Allah, He will make a way out for you. There are places, but you have to search and find. You have to do the job. There are brothers teaching Arabic. And it may be a must for some. If the language is not there, it's difficult for the heart to soften. It's difficult because you don't know what's going on. You don't know what's going on. Unless you happen to know the ayat, which the Imam is reciting. But it is essential, my brothers and sisters in Islam, that we interact with the Book of Allah. That when we hear the reminders, that we are not like those whom Allah says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Woe to them, wail. Some of the ulama say, wail is a valley in Jahannam. And others say, wail is just any woe, any threat. Meaning it's a major sin. It's a major sin for one's heart to be hardened against the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now let me quote to you Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, as he divided the hearts into three kinds. A healthy heart, a dead heart, and a sick heart. He says concerning the healthy heart, first, on the day of resurrection, only those who come to Allah with a sound, healthy heart will be saved. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On the day where no wealth or children will be of any benefit, except the one who comes to Allah with a sound, healthy heart. قَلْبٌ سَلِيمٌ. Salim, from salam, yaslam, to be free from something, to be peaceful from something, in a state of peace from shirk and other forms of disobedience and sins. Allah says, وَأُزِّفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. هَذَا مَا تُوعَدُونَ لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ حَفِيظٍ مَنْ خَشِيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ. On the day of judgment, Allah says, and paradise will be brought near to the righteous, not far. It will be right in front of them. It will be said to them, this is what you were promised. لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ. One who is always repenting and returning to Allah. حَفِيظ. One who was safeguarding the deen of Allah. The Prophet ﷺ told Ibn Abbas, احفظ الله يحفظك. Safeguard the rights of Allah, the deen of Allah, by doing the obligations, staying away from the prohibitions. Allah will safeguard you and protect you. On that day, لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ حَفِيظ. The one who was keen on putting Islam into practice. When he learned an ayah, when he learned a hadith, when he heard a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ, when he receives an advice, halatul, halatul. That's the only way it's going to work. Otherwise, it's not going to work. Alright? It's not going to work, ikhwan. Brothers and sisters. Then the ayah continues, but what is also one of the qualities of this person? مَنْ خَشِيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ. He who fears the most merciful and the unseen. The scholars have interpreted this in more than one way. One of them is, in the unseen when no one sees you, but Allah. Or the fact that Allah is unseen. You can't see Him, but you believe in Him. So you have fear of Him, although you don't see Allah Jalla Jalaluh, وَتَقَدَّسَتْ أَسْمَاؤُهُ. وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ. And He comes with a repentive heart. So قَلْب سَلِيم, قَلْب مُنِيب. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَلَا وَأَنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. Verily, in the body there's a lump of flesh. There's a piece of flesh. If it is sound, then the whole body will be sound. If it is corrupt, then the whole body will be corrupt. It is the heart, which we are sleeping concerning. Some of us have had dead hearts for years. And the disaster is that the brother or the sister, they don't even know. They don't even know that they have an illness. They think that they are rightly guided. But it is obvious. Allah knows the conditions of our hearts. In defining the healthy heart, the following has been said. It is a heart cleansed from any passion that challenges what Allah commands or disputes what He forbids. It is free from any impulses which contradict His good. As a result, it is safeguarded against the worship of anything other than Him, and seeks the judgment of no other except that of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Its services are exclusively reserved for Allah, willingly and lovingly. Willingly, you want to do it. You can't wait. Some of the brothers we see in the masajid, especially the youth, mashallah tabarakallah, whom Allah has blessed, alhamdulillah, we need to follow the footsteps, those who are a little older. They are so hungry. It's shocking. I'd be sitting next to them, and they have hundreds of questions. And alhamdulillah, predominantly, almost everything, when they learn, they put into practice. No dispute, no negotiation, no going back and forth. Their hearts are still, alhamdulillah, sound. But that's how each one of us needs to be. It's like that. When the reminder comes, it's like that. You should do it willingly, lovingly, for the sake of Allah. You want to please Allah, your master. Nowadays, some people feel like this about the kafil. Huh? Mr. Kafil with the iqama, with your salary. Anything for the kafil. How would you like your tea? I'll make the tea. And I'll go. I'll become a carpet for you. So you may walk comfortably. For some kafil, man, who is nothing. Nothing. He's only a tool which Allah allowed to be in your life for your rizq to be given to you. That's all. If he goes away, someone else will come. If you go away, you'll go to someone else. It's not the end of the world. So we want to please a person. Even often it's against the deen of Allah. It will be something haram, but the boss likes it. So we must put it into practice. But then when it comes to your master, the one who will judge you on the day of judgment, malish. That I don't need to do. Where's the love, man? Where's the love? It's fake. Brothers and sisters, it's fake love. We talk too much nowadays. Muslims, wonderful. Look, I'm one example. You hear me talking? We're very good at talking nowadays. But our righteous predecessors, they used to do. They would talk. They were eloquent. But they actually lived it. Both the speakers and the listeners. When the Prophet ﷺ would give him a reminder, he told them once, لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ مَا أَعْلَمْ لَضَحِكْتُمْ قَلِيلًا وَلَبَكَيْتُمْ كَثِيرًا. He told his companions, if you knew what I know, you would laugh only a little. You would laugh just randomly sometimes, but you would weep a lot. And then they said the companions were sitting down, sobbing, crying with sound like a little baby. You know when the baby cries and he's barely breathing? That extensive, hardcore crying, not the typical just, you know, weeping. Real teal crying. That's how the Sahaba used to be. When the Prophet ﷺ would give them a reminder, they were awake and they would put it into practice. We don't necessarily do that today. Willingly and lovingly, with total reliance, relating all matters to Him in fear, hope and sincere dedication. When it loves in the way of Allah. And when it detests in the way of Allah. You love for the sake of Allah, you hate for the sake of Allah. When it gives for Allah. And when you withhold for the sake of Allah. Nevertheless, all this will not suffice for salvation. Until you do not put any person or deed or faith above that of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All that will not benefit. Until he becomes your ultimate imam. He is al-Imam al-A'zam. If we want to call anyone al-Imam al-A'zam, it is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the greatest Imam. That is our Imam. And many of us are foreign to him. So much so that if he saw us, he wouldn't recognize us. If he saw some of us in the street, he would not be able to tell whether we are Muslims or Christians or Jews or Hindus or what. That's not acceptable. Wouldn't you want the Messenger of Allah to identify you? Say, this brother looks like from my ummah. So he may intercede for you on the day of judgment. So you may get the intercession. So you may be raised in the degrees of Jannah if you were to enter Jannah. Saved from the fire if you were meant to go to the fire. Get a sip of water where you will never be thirsty ever after from al-hawd of the Messenger of Allah. Don't you want that? It's not going to happen if you are foreign to a sunnah. And some aspects of the sunnah are obligatory. When I mean sunnah, not the voluntary, meaning that which came in the ahadith, some of which is obligatory. We're not going to go over it again. I'm sure you know and I know what we're talking about. He must not give precedence to any other faith or words or deeds over those of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah bless him and grant him peace. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. All you who believe, do not place yourselves above Allah and His Messenger. And fear Allah. Verily Allah is all hearing, all knowing. What that means, according to the ulama and the tafsir, you don't, when the hadith comes to you, when the ayah comes to you, you don't put yourself in above that. Say, but this and that. That doesn't work. And Allah made that prohibited. And fear Allah. Wattaqullah. Have taqwa of Allah. Allah is all hearing, all knowing. He knows and He hears. That means that you will be brought to account according to what Allah knew and what Allah heard. And we cannot afford that. If we're not doing the job, we cannot afford that. This is that healthy heart. I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to grant all of us a healthy heart. This one, I hope no one here is of that. The dead heart. The one in the between we'll deal with. But this one, this person is destroyed. This is the opposite of the healthy heart, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says. It does not know its Lord and does not worship Him as He commands, in the way which He likes and in which He is pleased. It clings instead to its lusts and desires, even if these are likely to incur Allah's wrath and anger. It worships things other than Allah, and its love and hatred is for other than Allah. Its giving and withholding is for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that it does arises from its whims, which are of paramount importance to it and preferred above the pleasure of Allah. Its whims are its imam. The desires are the imam. Its lust is its guide. Its ignorance is its leader. It is immersed in its concern with worldly objectives. If it is called to Allah and the Akhirah from a distance, it does not respond to the advice. And instead, it follows the cunning shaitan. Life angers and pleases it, and passion makes it deaf and blind to anything except what is evil. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ يعني someone who is destroyed, beginning with the kafir and moving to those among the Muslims who are totally away from the teachings of Islam. Someone who is in the state, probably on the verge of leaving Islam, because someone worshipping other than Allah cannot remain within the boundaries of Islam. The sick heart, which is what most of us probably are suffering from. This is the heart which, with life in it, as well as illness. The former sustains it at one moment, the latter at another. And it follows whichever one of the two manages to dominate. It has love for Allah, faith in Him, sincerity towards Him, and reliance upon Him. And these are what gives it life. These are what give it life. It also has craving for lust and pleasure, and prefers them and strives to experience them. It is full of self-admiration. Somebody says, you know, I'm all that. Which can lead to its own destruction. It listens to two callers. One calling it to Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the hereafter. And the other calling it to the fleeting pleasures of the world. It responds to whichever one of the two happens to have most influence over it at the time. So we're going like this, in the balance. One day you're all right, the next day you're not all right. One day you are doing the salah right, you're obeying Allah and His Messenger, following the sunnah. The next day we go back to leaving things alone and going back to our old ways. Inconsistency. But the problem with that is that this is very similar to gambling. And gambling is haram in Islam. Yani you play lottery. Huh? If you get the number, if it strikes, then you become a millionaire. Otherwise you lose your money. Gambling. You can't gamble with that kind of stuff. I mean, do you know how you will end? What if Allah decrees that you end while your iman is low? And you are in the state of the sick heart, following and leaning more towards the color of the dunya rather than the hereafter, then what one will do? What would be the consequences from that moment on? Don't ask. That requires a lecture of its own, which we will deal with inshallah, concerning what will happen after one of us departs from this life. The Shaykh rahimahullah said in commenting on the whole discussion, the first heart is alive, submitted to Allah, humble, sensitive and aware. The second is brittle and dead. The third wavers between either its safety or its ruins. He said, rahimahullah, pay attention to this. This is interesting. Little success from Allah. Bad views. Unawareness of the truth. Corruption of the heart. Laziness in making zikr. Wasting time. Distaste for the creation, estrangement between the servant and his Lord, the prevention of the supplication from being answered, hardening of the heart, the termination of blessings from one's provision and lifespan, the prevention of knowledge, humiliation at the hands of the enemy, constricting of the chest, prolonged grief and sorrow, a wretched life of poverty, and a gloomy state of being are all produced from sins and neglecting to remember Allah. Just as crops are produced from water and burning from fire, and the opposites of these things are produced from the obedience to Allah. Did you remember them? I know the baby was a little excited, but whoever is the father, if they can kindly pick up the child, inshallah ta'ala, jazakum Allah khairan. It looks like they want to get on the camera. Not yet. When you start giving lectures, inshallah. Tayyib. So these were a series of offenses. If you were to be taken to court for that, you'll be in prison forever. Right? Of all these problems, laziness and of dhikr and destruction of the heart and all these things are all a consequence of sins. And don't belittle the sins. We're not talking about major sins, minor sins as well. And we dealt with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, how minor sins will destroy one by while accumulating them. And the scholars say, being consistent about a small sin becomes a grave sin in your case. Doing something that is considered minor over and over again, this becomes a kabira from the major sins. Because you are belittling the rights of Allah. It becomes unimportant to you that it's not a big deal to disobey Allah. Or the other interpretation, that you will continue to do it until it becomes a kabira in your case, which will lead you to other kabair. A number of explanations given by the ulama. Now, Ibn al-Qayyim, I will quote one more thing of Ibn al-Qayyim, then we're going to go back in the days. We're going to have a flashback. The abd is never afflicted with punishment. Guess from what? What is the worst punishment that one may receive? If you were to ask someone today, say losing my job, getting an exit visa while I want to stay here, losing my money, having a car accident, somebody dying, something along these lines. But according to Ibn Qayyim, he said, the abd is never afflicted with a punishment more severe than the hardness of the heart and being away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the worst thing in the world. And what's worse than that is when we don't even know that we are in this condition. What's even worse, what is even more of a calamity and a punishment, is when we don't even pay attention that we are in that state. We are with hard hearts and we are away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An-nar was created for melting the iron hearts. So there's two ways. Melting the iron hearts can be done in two ways. Either by the reminder today in this life, not necessarily today, in this life, or it's going to melt in Jahannam. So each one of us has a choice. Either you agree to have your heart melt today in this life so it may soften, or you wait until you go to the hereafter and then Jahannam will do the job for you. Would anyone like to go for the second? I didn't think so. So that means that we must do some things. Let's look at those who came before us. On the authority of Ja'far ibn Burqan, he said, I came to know that Salman al-Farisi, everybody knows the story of Salman al-Farisi, radiyallahu anhu wa ardah, Salman the Persian, who went through a number of religions, including Christianity, before Allah guided him to Islam. You probably have heard the story somewhere in the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or a book called Rijalun Hawla al-Rasul, Men Around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Look what he said, man. Look at this brother's knowledge and wisdom. He used to say, three things make me laugh, and three things make me cry. Three things make me laugh, three things make me cry. And none of them is a comedy, by the way. Some movie that he saw that made him laugh. You'll see what makes him laugh. He said, I laugh at the one who is hopeful of the world, yet death seeks him. He's looking for the dunya, and death is just around the corner. The one who is neglectful of his Lord, while he is not neglected by him. You are neglecting Allah Azza wa Jal, but Allah is not negligent of you. He sees and knows every single move that you do. Then he said, I laugh at the one who laughs at the top of his voice, as some of us laugh today, you know, that extreme one, while he does not know whether he is pleasing his Lord or displeasing him. Laughing hard, but you don't know at that state, where do you stand in the sight of Allah? Are you pleasing Allah or are you displeasing Allah? He laughs at those people. Who does he cry for? Three things make me cry. Look what makes him cry. Parting from our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions. Separation from the Messenger of Allah, which probably most of us have never cried concerning. Being away from him, not given the chance to see him alayhi salatu wasalam, and even, you know, shake his hand. The terror, the second thing that makes him cry, the terror of the onset of the pangs of death or the agonies of death, yani the moment of death, just before you die, your condition, what would you be in? What condition would you be in? And lastly, standing in front of the Lord of the worlds, while not knowing whether I will be turned towards fire or paradise. You don't know where you will end up. No one knows. Except those who are giving glad tidings about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That makes him cry. That's Salman al-Farisi for you. Hassan al-Basri, al-Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah, was fasting one of these voluntary days. And someone brought some water for the Shaykh to break his fast. So he started weeping. They said, why do you weep? He said, I remembered the statement of Allah in the Quran. وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ أَصْحَابَ الْجَنَّةِ أَنْ أَفِيضُوا عَلَيْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ أَوْ مِمَّا رَزَقَكُمُ اللَّهِ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَهُمَا عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. He said, I remembered the statement of Allah in the Quran, and the people of the hellfire shall call upon the inhabitants of the paradise, and they will say to them, pour on us some water, or that which Allah has provided you with. They will beg them for water because of the extensiveness of the heat in Jahannam. What would the people of Jannah tell them? إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَهُمَا عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. Verily Allah has made them prohibited for the disbelievers. The water and the provision. He used to say, it is befitting for the one who knows that death is his place of arrival. The hour is his appointed time. And standing in front of Allah the Most High is His place of meeting, that its sadness lengthens, that you become sad for some duration of time over the reality of these circumstances. Thabit al-Banani said, we were following a funeral procession, janazah, and we saw nothing but people covering their faces, crying, or covering their faces while reflecting. You go to the janazah today, and people are laughing in that hall next to it where they're drinking water. Regular conversations, as if they did not just finish burying someone in the grave. Only few, you see, are actually affected by the whole funeral procession. Some only take heed. Others, they don't take a reminder. Life goes on for them. But our righteous predecessors were unlike us today. Ibrahim al-Taymi used to say, the one who is not afflicted with sadness and grief should fear being from the people of the fire. Because Allah said that the people of paradise will say, وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَذْهَبَ عَنَّا الْحَزَنَ. The people of the paradise will say, oh, praises due to Allah who removed grief away from us. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu once came in and he saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lying down on a straw mat which left some marks on his back. So he started crying. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, ya Umar, why do you cry? He said, I thought of the Caesars and the Khosrows, you know, Kisra, the kings of the Persians. And they're sitting on silver beds with adornment and so on and so forth. And you are the Messenger of Allah and you are in this condition. The Prophet ﷺ told him, does it not make you happy that they will have the dunya and we will have the next? That this world will be for them, but we will have the one to come. Alayhi salatu wasalam, who used to go hungry for months, no fire would be kindled in his house because there was no food to cook. He would live off water and dates with his wife Aisha radiallahu anha. Look at our condition today. You eat whenever you want, whatever you want, however you want, in whichever restaurant you prefer, with the amount that you like, with cheese and without cheese, with extra sauce and without sauce. Yeah, the way you like it. But that's not how the Prophet ﷺ had it. And we wish to get what he got, alayhi salatu wasalam. I'm not telling you stop eating, brothers and sisters. Some people go to extreme. We may enjoy the halal, but we should not be overwhelmed with the halal where we leave the obligations of Allah, where we don't fulfill the rights of Allah because we are too entertained in this dunya. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, again, dealt with the hadith of Hudhayfa, which is reported to us by Muslim, Imam Muslim al-Sahih, rahimahullah. It's the hadith of the fitan. The Prophet ﷺ said that fitan, trials and tribulations will be presented to the hearts as a reed mat is interwoven stick by stick. Like you know the mats, stick one over the other, like that. Fitan, trials and tribulations will be presented to the heart. Any heart which absorbs it will have a black spot put in it. And any heart which rejects it will have a white spot put in it. Until the heart of the one who rejects it become white like a white stone. And the one which absorbs it, it will become like an overturned vessel. The first heart, the Prophet ﷺ said, it will not be affected by any fitna afterwards as long as the heavens and the earth endure. After you reject the fitan, when presented to your heart and the white spot is put in it, your heart will become like a white stone. So no matter what happens afterwards, you will never absorb the fitan. As long as the heavens and the earth endure. But then he said, and the other one, the heart will become dark and rusty like an overturned vessel. You know when you fry eggs in the pot? After a number of years of using it, if you look at the back of the pot, how is it? Black. Huh? From burning often and often. So he said the heart will become like an overturned vessel, not able to recognize the good nor reject the evil, but rather being absorbed with its desires. And this is the essence of the calamity.
This is why we have reached the level of the dead heart, which we have been addressing, or the hard heart. Because of these fitan that were presented, a woman walking by, a place to lie, an opportunity to cheat, any sin that is presented is a fitna. You do it, it will put a black spot in your heart. You keep doing it, it will become like a reed mat interwoven stick by stick, until your heart will become black. And Allah says, كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ Nay, rather has covered their hearts what they used to earn. So then their heart will become blind. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah gave us an excellent explanation. He said the trials which are presented to the heart are of two kinds. Shahwa, false desire, and Shubha, doubt. The first one corrupts one's intentions and desires, whereas the second one corrupts one's knowledge and belief system. It will corrupt your belief system and your knowledge, where you don't have the correct belief system. He said, speaking about such trials, he rahimahullah said, hearts when exposed to such fitna are of two types. A heart which when exposed to such trials absorbs it like a sponge that soaks up water, leaving it in a black stain. Such a heart continues to soak up the various trials that are presented to it until it becomes dark and corrupted, which is what is meant by overturned vessel. So when this occurs, two dangerous and deadly diseases take hold of it until it plunges into destruction. Firstly, confusing good with evil. So it neither recognizes the good, nor does it reject the evil. Actually, the Shaykh said, if the problem becomes really tough, if it really overtakes you, then the person will see the evil as good, and the good as evil. The sunnah as bid'ah, and the bid'ah as sunnah. And the truth is falsehood, and the falsehood is truth. And you cannot do anything about this person. What can you do about this person? Nothing. How does one reach this particular level? By these sins, by these fitan that are presented to the heart. He said, secondly, the second disease, judging by its whims and desires over and against what Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. So this person becomes enslaved by its whims and desires, and they are being led by them also. As for the other heart, it is a heart which is a white heart in which the light of Iman is bright and its radiance is illuminating. So when trials are presented to such a heart, it rejects and turns away from them. This further increases its light and illumination and its strength. So whenever you are presented with a fitna, anything that the shaitan whispers to you from disobedience to Allah, you have to be tough. You have to be strong, like a boxer with the sins. Knock them out. When it comes to you, don't be weak. Say, let me just this time. Not only this time. Be tough. Be a strong man. And for the sister, be a strong woman, like the mothers of the believers. Like the mothers of the believers. The wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahabiyat. They were strong women in a sense, in commitment to the deen of Allah. And so we should be of the same caliber as them, to the best of our ability. I was supposed to quote to you an interesting story of Abu Ghayb. But perhaps, inshallah, we will try to squeeze it in a later lecture. Because time is not on our hand, and I do not want to hold you for too long, since time is coming in later. So we will leave alone Abu Ghayb, but remember the name. Remember Abu Ghayb, because it's a very interesting story. It's a manifestation of how one reacts when being presented to the fitan. And we can give any other practical example from your own life. You have your own experience when you were presented with a fitna and you turned away from it. For the sake of Allah, how you felt your iman was strong, and how you were able to overcome it afterwards. Whereas when you fell for it the first time, you almost become like a prisoner to it. You cannot let go. It handcuffs you. So you know this from your personal experience, I will not be able to give you the long story. It's a very long story. And I don't want anyone to, you know, be bored. Let's go to the bottom line of this. Akhi, you may be saying in yourself, okay, I think I'm afflicted with this disease. Yeah, I think I have the symptoms. And now you've depressed me, ultimately. You know, I don't know if I'm going to sleep tonight. And this is one of my objectives, by the way, so that we will make the necessary change. But will I leave you without a treatment? No. Inshallah, as the scholars provided you with the treatment, then I will simply share it with you. First and foremost, for one to soften the heart, one must understand the ayah and the Qur'an. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُ. Those who believe, and through the remembrance of Allah, their hearts reach tranquility. Is it not by the remembrance of Allah that the hearts reach tranquility? A rhetorical question. Indeed it is. Through the remembrance of Allah. First, dua. Dua. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. And if my slaves ask you concerning me, then tell them, it doesn't even say that tell them, but it's understood from the context, then I am near. I was near in Allah's knowledge, not that Allah Azza wa Jal is with us here, as many Muslims believe that Allah is everywhere, not that. Allah is near while He is above His creation in a manner which befits His majesty. Then I am near. I respond to the supplication of the one who calls upon me. So let them respond to me and believe in me so they may be rightly guided. Look how gentle this reminder is from Allah. Allah is calling us. If you ask the Prophet ﷺ about Allah, then Allah is near. He will answer you if you supplicate. So you should ask Allah in your dua to grant you a soft heart. Don't deprive yourself, don't be miserly and stingy over asking Allah to give you a soft heart. We ask for a lot of dunya matters, for a bigger, better job, higher salary, but we should really give some time for this poor heart that we have oppressed in our bodies. Ask Allah to give you a sound heart, a healthy heart that understands the truth and puts it into practice. The dua, first and foremost. Second, remember that. Remember that. The Prophet ﷺ told his companions in the beginning, I had prevented you from visiting the graves, but now I am commanding you to visit the graves. Verily in it you will find a reminder. In one narration in Hadith he said, by such visits you will soften your heart and it will bring tears to the eyes and it will serve as a reminder of the hereafter. Go into the graveyard when you see the dead people that have preceded you, or the dead people that are dying around you, or you simply think about death. And the righteous predecessors used to be very mindful of death. Every salah for them, they will believe is the last salah of their lives. They did not, because no one knows when death will come around. So remember death. This is means of your heart softening bi-ibnillahi azza wa jal. Thirdly, the Qur'an. Allahu nazzala ahsan al-hadith. كتابا متشابها متانيا تقشعر منه جلود الذين يخشون ربهم ثم تلين جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله ذلك هدى الله يهدي به من يشاء ومن يضلل الله فما له من هاد. Allah has sent down the best book, the best speech, the Quran. Its parts resembling one another in goodness and truth. The skins of those who fear their Lord shiver when they hear it or when they recite it from the fear of Allah. It shivers from the fear of Allah, from khashya. Then their skin and their heart soften to the reminder of Allah Azza wa Jal. It softens to the reminder of Allah Azza wa Jal. Verily, this is the guidance of Allah. He guides to it whomever He wills. And whosoever Allah guides, then none will be able to guide. The best speech is the Qur'an. The skins of those who fear their Lord, it shivers from the Qur'an. Again, so we should learn what the Qur'an means. So when you stand in Ramadan and Taraweeh, you will not be wishing that the Imam will expedite the Taraweeh. You will not be looking for the one who prays the shortest number of verses in the rak'ah. Because you yourself don't want to be in the masjid. But it is a custom that you have brought up, you have been brought up upon. You have been accustomed to that you should pray Taraweeh like everybody else prays Taraweeh. So you go there tired, lazy, and not really in the mood for the salah. And you know that many of us have this particular feeling. Because akhi and ukhti, we don't understand what the imam is saying. That's why the scholars say it is allowed to seek an imam who recites in a way that is effective, that affects the heart. Because you need to interact with the Quran. Lastly, righteous deeds. Doing good, avoiding evil. Something that Allah has given all of us the ability to do. It is something that is within your reach. It doesn't require travel. It doesn't require spending money. It doesn't require excessive work. It is something within your reach. And this time that Allah gave you, these 24 hours a day, do what Allah wants of you to do. And stay away from what Allah wants you to stay away from. And this is the best way for you to be rightly guided. This is the istiqamah. When Ubadah ibn Sabit was it for Sufyan, asked the Prophet ﷺ to give him an advice. Give me an advice. He said, قُلْ آمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقِمْ. Say, I believe in Allah. And the names and attributes of Allah, the way that you're supposed to believe, then remain upright. Then stay on a straight course. Then don't go off. Ibn Abbas said concerning the ayah which was revealed in Surah Hud, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتُ. So Allah commanded the Prophet ﷺ to remain upright as he was commanded. He said this is the most difficult verse upon the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ in the whole Quran. When Allah told him to remain upright. After you've been guided, don't go off. So when you do something, don't stop doing it. And when you learn something, put it into practice. Lastly, brothers and sisters in Islam, I conclude with these ayat from the book of Allah. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَلَا تَوَلَّوْا عَنْهُ وَأَنْتُمْ تَسْمَعُونَ وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ قَالُوا سَمِعْنَا وَهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الصُّمُّ الْبُكْمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ وَلَوْ عَلِمَ اللَّهُ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا لَأَسْمَعَهُمْ وَلَوْ أَسْمَعَهُمْ لَتَوَلَّوا وَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَلِلرَّسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَأَنَّهُ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. Allah says, this is the last thing that can be said. All you who believe, obey Allah and His Messenger and do not turn away from them whilst you hear. And do not be like those who say that we hear, but they really hear not. They hear the words, but it doesn't reach the heart. What did Allah say concerning them? Verily, the most evil of the creation in the sight of Allah are as-sum al-bukmu alladhina la yaqilun. Those who are deaf in the sight of Allah are as-sum al-bukmu alladhina la yaqilun. Those who are deaf and blind and they do not understand. And had Allah known any goodness in them, He would have allowed them to hear the hearing that will be put into practice. And had He made them hear, they would have turned away while being neglectful. They will turn away. Had Allah known goodness, but Allah knows that there is no goodness, that's why they're not. That's why Allah did not allow them to hear in the manner which makes it to the heart. Then Allah concluded the ayat by saying, O you who believe, respond to Allah and His Messenger. If they call you to that which will give you life, your real life is in the ta'ah of Allah and His Messenger. And know that Allah comes between the man and his heart. Allah comes between you and your heart, where you will no longer be able to remain a believer. You have no control over dying in a state of goodness. Allah may turn your heart over. As Prophet ﷺ used to say, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. He used to ask Allah, the one who turns the heart over, to keep his heart firm on the deen. Who? The Messenger of Allah. And Allah warned us, He may turn the heart over and know that to Allah you will be gathered. This is what I wanted to share with you this particular evening. I hope inshallah ta'ala some dead hearts will be revived and some ill hearts will be cured, beginning with mine and moving on to yours. And Allah is the one who grants success. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. If you have any questions, you may ask. Yes, sir. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah.
What are the practical steps to take it one step at a time? You know, there is a spiritual dimension, how to increase it a little bit by little, so that people don't lose faith or, as you might have said, get bored and teach.
Right.
So how to keep on going forward from that?
JazakAllah khair. Very good question, barakAllah khair. Thank you first for whatever you mentioned. Ask Allah to accept our deeds. Concerning that, it's just like anything in life. For example, when one wants to exercise in order to strengthen one's muscles, they say, those who have the experts in that field, that you know, you don't come and do 500 push-ups in one day. You know, you exhaust your muscles and then you stop for a couple of weeks. Rather, you do it in a gradual sense, where you divide that, you know, what you intend on doing over a period of time, so it will become consistent. So, Prophet said, the most beloved of deeds to Allah are those which are consistent, even if they may be little. So, with that understanding, one should begin by doing things that are practical and easy. Many acts of worship are very easy to do. Some require effort, strength, and so on and so forth. Some are within reach. So we begin with that which is easily done. And I don't need to comment on that. We all understand what I'm talking about in the various forms, even in terms of character. The way you treat the people around you, you know, you try to follow the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is all included. So once you do the things that you're able to do, your iman will grow in such a fashion where you can eventually expand and accumulate more things, and spiritually you'll grow accordingly, then inshallah, bi-idhnillah, you'll be able to remain steadfast and have perseverance until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you begin with that which is easily done. Alhamdulillah, there are plenty of things that we should do that we are not doing today, that we can begin with, inshallah. Everybody knows his own shortcomings, including myself. I hope that answers the question.
Sometimes we find non-Muslims who we think that they have pure hearts, okay? So how come they are not Muslims, so their iman is not correct, but in the way they approach the prayer, devotion, and they deal with people, we see that their hearts seem to us to be very pure. Is this a form of hypocrisy, or that their sickness is kind of hidden?
What was this, a form of hypocrisy or what?
Or that their sickness in the heart is kind of hidden, the disease is hidden.
Right. No,
as Muslims believe that the aqidah is not the true one, then this is a real sickness. But sometimes we see the non-Muslims, some of them, those who have some kind of spirituality or some kind of knowledge or some kind of good manners and character, but they have very aggressive personality.
Right.
And they even tend to distract Muslims from Islam.
Correct.
So how come this disease is hidden from the normal Muslim?
Because this is what they call the, this is called satanic soundness, or what appears to be a pure heart. You see, Shaytan, alayhi la'natullah al-da'ima, he has tricks up his sleeves, as they say. You see, he works in a number of ways. He deals with the believers unlike he deals with the disbelievers. And he tries whatever will work to mislead someone from the path of Allah. So whenever he sees these evil people, people of other faith, particularly those involved in propagation of their faith, who appear to be submissive to God and to be fearful of God and have all this, you know, this drama that they put on in the movie, that they play on a daily basis, this is actually from the tricks of the shaitan, who has first fooled them. By Allah, their hearts are so corrupt that, let me just quote to you an incident from the righteous predecessors. Some people came to Ibn Abbas and he told them, they told them that that the Jews, they don't get any waswasa in their salah. Okay? The way Muslims will stand in prayer and they get all kinds of waswasa, whispers from the shaitan. They said the Jews don't get any. He said, what is the shaitan going to do with a dead heart? What is he going to do in their heart? He doesn't even need to whisper anything. They think they're in khushu' upon a false religion. As for their treatment, then that treatment is in order to guide the people, to misguide the people to their ways. And it is really for worthy objective. The difference between a believer and a disbeliever is that whatever we do things is for the sake of Allah. Whereas a disbeliever does not even take that into consideration. He will do the deed with the intention to gain whatever he's trying to gain. And God is not on his list to begin with. So this is why they treat people in this way, because they have a goal and objective. But we Muslims are more deserving of actually having these particular qualities of being kind and things of that, just as the Prophet ﷺ used to be. But because we have become foreign to his way of life, his conduct, his treatment to others, then we have developed our own way that is against his way, alayhi salatu wasalam. But really, no one was better than him, even among those who fake it. He was real, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he was genuine. Hey, Allahu a'lam.
So if somebody born a child, what is supposed to do? What is supposed to give him before you reach the mature time, Islamically, in the Sunnah and the Kitab and Sunnah?
The boy before he reaches puberty?
Before you mature, you born a baby today.
Nah.
What is supposed to give him to the time you mature? Islamically.
Everything that like he, you should teach him the Quran. Preferably because at young age Arabic is very accessible for them and very easily learned. So you teach them the Arabic language, you teach them that you make them memorize the Hadith Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you teach them good character, you make them recognize Allah. From young age, from 4 years old, 5 years old, always make them mindful of Allah.
Because I want to ask, because some they say you born a baby to bargain head in 7 days.
You're talking about what you deal with the newborn, actually, not until maturity.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, the sunnah concerning the newborn are the following. Of course, naming him prior to being born is fine, because there were times where this was done. Or naming him at the time of being born is also done, and there are narrations which mention naming him when he's 7 days old. Okay. This will go along with shaving the head. Shaving the head at 7 days, then you weigh them, and then you give the equivalent in silver. Okay? Another thing that you do to a newborn is that you get some dates, and you do what they call tahniq, which is basically rubbing the gums of the newborn with dates. You don't feed him a date because he will not manage. Rather, you put some dates and then you make it soft and you rub the gums of the newborn with dates. This is what the Prophet ﷺ did to one of the newborn children. As for the adhan in the right hand and the iqamah in the left hand, Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah had in the beginning labeled the hadith of the giving the adhan in the right hand as hasan, okay, as acceptable, whereas the hadith about the iqamah in the left hand is da'if. Later on in his life, rahimahullah, after making some further research, he came to know that this hadith is actually mawdu'. And the reason why they had been referring to Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, and other scholars would mention it in the book, and they referred it to a particular scholar, but when the Shaykh went to the actual research without depending on the quotation, he found that this was never the case. So then this hadith is unauthentic. Calling the adhan in the right ear, and the iqamah in the left ear, or just calling the adhan in the right ear, is not from the sunnah, not authentic sunnah. If somebody did it in the past, because they didn't know, like myself, then alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, we ask Allah to accept according to the nawaya. But now that you know, you leave it alone. وَمَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا لِلَّهِ عَوَضَ اللَّهُ خَرْمٍ. Allah will give you something better in return. So this is, and then the aqiqah, you sacrifice for a boy, two sheep, and for a girl, one. And then some of the scholars say it is preferred that you divide it in a fashion where one third for you, one third you give out to the family members or the poor, and one third you cook and you invite the people over to your house. And this is what I recall right now from the etiquettes or the how to welcome a newborn in Islam. Allahu Ta'ala a'lam. Now, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah.
I would like to say regarding the quality of the heart. At the time of the Sahaba, they used to assist each other a great deal. Relationship and community.
Right.
Whereas today, the people are, I noticed, are very divided. Divided among tribal lines, divided among nationalistic lines, language lines. Some people even divide among madhab.
Right.
And they are very divided. Some people even go beyond. So doctor may not even have respect for the ordinary man.
Right.
How can we help to bring the people into some community? So we need assistance with the heart. It's not a one-man show.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah, this requires knowledge. The only real solution is that people learn the deen of Allah. Because while someone, this is the jahiliyyah, everything you mentioned are live examples of jahiliyyah, which as one of the du'at said, jahiliyyah in the 20th century. Tribalism and things of this nature is un-Islamic in every way, shape or form. Prophet ﷺ stopped that. Even when the Ansar said Ansar and Muhajirin said Muhajirin, he said, da'uha in ahlatina. Leave that alone, this is filthy. This kind of division. So this needs knowledge. And knowledge is being presented. Alhamdulillah, we have weekly classes in English, some in tafsir, some in aqidah, and some in other aspects. We have some brothers have, when Dr. Yahya conducts a class in Arabic for the those who want to learn Arabic. We have the Friday sermons in English at the, some of the da'wah centers, also translated to English or Urdu and other masajid. Lectures are being held. So one must join the crowd. Each one, alhamdulillah, these are the brothers who have goodness and sisters, but one should try to join everything that is going on, because through knowledge, one can, as a community, we can get over these differences, but individually, it's difficult. So we need unity upon the truth, that is, and we need knowledge to help us move forward, inshallah. Wallahu a'lam. Yes, sir. Walaikum salam. Everything you mentioned is already available. Here's the camera in front of me, so so that this eventually will be on a DVD, and then it'll be uploaded to YouTube also. And this is a recorder, so it'll be available in audio. And there's a website called www.onewaytoparadise.net. onewaytoparadise. I'm not trying to show you my spelling skills, I've just said it so many times, I memorized it. .net, not .com.
Okay.
And everything that you've heard, everything that is being done in English, whether the classes or the Friday sermons or the Friday translation, the khutbah, everything is on the website. Along with reading material, a portion for Muslims, another one for the non-Muslims, a blog for you to input your ideas, fatawa being shared. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, it's from the bounties of Allah. And some of the brothers here have helped us put this thing together and supported it in various ways. So we thank everyone. We ask Allah to reward them with goodness for joining. But all that is available, inshallah.
Thank you.
Alhamdulillah. Allah is merciful. It's from the mercy of Allah.